Here you had in North Philadelphia, a prominent school that could give the greatest education, but wasn't allowing black kids in. And so outside the wall, you had tempers flaring.
The NAACP started picketing here May 1st and led to yesterday's filing in Philadelphia federal court of legal action on behalf of 7 Negro boys ages 6 to 9.
Stephen Girard left most of his fortune for a school for orphan boys. It was in Mr. Girard's will that this school would only be open to white boys. But that was almost 140 years before. All through that hot summer of 1965, protesters led by Cecil B. Moore were here every day.
Now is the time.
Martin Luther King came to support the protests.
To straighten up Girard College, now is the time.
The ruling came down in May of 1968. I was only 8 years old. That September, 4 of us walked through the gates. But this is a story that goes well beyond 1968. What's really important is all that Stephen Girard, the man, did for thousands of children he never met.
Good day, Mr. Girard. And how are the pains today, sir?
Be assured I pay them no attention.
Very well. Then let us resume the business of finalizing your will.
The will? I'm afraid the moment I hand it to my relatives, they want to tear it apart.
I won't let that happen, sir.
You understand, the most important thing to me is building the college. I'm not the least bit interested in making any of my family millionaires.
The will shall withstand all scrutiny. I trust you believe that. And when the public becomes aware of what you are leaving behind for the city, for the countless destitute boys, no judge will find favor with your greedy relations.
My family, they believe, every last one of them, that they are truly deserving. They wish me to think they are hungry and poor. Ever since the moment our mother died, I was like a father. I was 11 years old when I took charge of the children.
Stephen Girard was the oldest of 14 children. He grew up in a small, cramped house, and he had a lot of responsibilities imposed on him from an early age.
Stephen Girard's father was a merchant shipper out of Bordeaux, France. He was, by all accounts, a distant and difficult man. Father and son did not get along terribly well.
Stephen Girard left home at the age of 14, and he spends the next 12 years sailing the seas, learning the business of international shipping.
Because he's a very tough guy who wanted to achieve what he wanted his own way.
Girard arrives in June of 1776. It's obviously an extraordinary political time in Philadelphia, but it was a pretty vibrant economic time as well.
You look up and down the wharves and docks, and it's nothing but a forest of ships. And Girard gets a piece of this very, very quickly. Soon he owns 10 ships of his own. He's trading to the West Indies, to South America, and making a beachhead for American commerce in China.
His approach was that he wanted his captains to stop in every available port, do as much business in each port as they could, make as much money in every port as they could. He was able to leverage those assets and do significantly higher profits.
Girard mastered every part of the business, from manufacturing to understanding how port taxes worked, navigation, and he worked harder than anyone else.
You know my stance. The single factor that will expose the will and threaten the college is the decree against the teaching of religion.
It is no such thing. They should be more concerned with a nation filled with men who are lazy and ignorant. I learned at sea, Monsieur De Wang, everything I need to conduct myself in the world.
That's fine, sir, but I must remind
you. Very well, then. Listen to what I have written. The teacher shall take great pains to instill in the minds of the scholars the purest principles of morality.
Girard originally did much of his trading business with the West Indies, and especially the French island of Saint-Domingue, today modern Haiti, until 1793, when a large-scale uprising of the slaves on Saint-Domingue turned his clients into refugees, whereupon Girard used his ships to rescue his former clients and take them off the island of Saint-Domingue to bring them to America.
Ironically, the good deed that Girard was performing by bringing these refugees to Philadelphia may very well have backfired. Although we wouldn't know until 1904 exactly how yellow fever was spread, it is quite plausible that one of the refugees was carrying yellow fever and, on arriving in Philadelphia in that hot summer of 1793, was bitten by a mosquito. That mosquito goes on to bite someone in Philadelphia, and an epidemic begins to spread.
The city was really in a crisis, and the city was slow but surely falling apart.
Girard sees this terrible situation in his adopted city. He sees doctors making what he thinks are idiotic mistakes, and he decides that he is going to make it better.
You know, sir, everyone still talks about what you did in 93, when the yellow fever struck.
There wasn't a soul in charge, only a bunch of Jacques doctors inflicting their mercury cures and leeches. I had to witness too many promising lives wasted. It's all loose.
Maybe so, sir. Shall we continue?
When the yellow fever was in Philadelphia, that's when he decided he wanted to do something.
The president left town, Congress left town, anybody who could leave town to avoid the yellow fever, to the point where the mayor of Philadelphia had to appeal for volunteers to be able to carry the sick and the infected to the hospitals.
Girard has experience with yellow fever outbreaks before in Haiti, and pretty quickly he's put in charge of the operation of a hospital at Bush Hill.
Bush Hill was a big, elegant house at today's 18th and Spring Garden Streets, and that was, at that time, the outskirts of town. And the mayor decides to make that house the city's yellow fever hospital. People were dying and sick in every room of the house, and it is a scene of utter urban devastation.
Girard installs a French doctor whose medical methods he agrees with, and he begins to run Bush Hill with characteristic efficiency. In a calamity that would take 10% of the population of the city, this was not an insignificant feat.
In Philadelphia's gravest moment of crisis, Girard practically saved the city.
One learns how to make money from uncertainty. This is a Delaware waterfront. I keep my wharf in perfect condition and my warehouses, but the rest of it just rots. Helltown is what they call it.
Well, you put up with it for all these years.
Maybe so, Monsieur De Wang, but it cannot go on, no.
Dr. Franklin, I think, would be quite pleased by your bequest for public improvements. A modern port, this Delaware Avenue, all linked by a railroad and canal.
And all that coal under the ground in Pennsylvania. But without a railroad and a proper port, it will never reach the market.
Risk-taking is important to progress. My favorite saying that would epitomize what I feel about public life is, behold the turtle who only makes progress when he sticks his neck out.
In his 40 years in Philadelphia, Girard sees that no one has tried to improve the city's waterfront. And in his unique Girard way, he decides that he can do it through the instructions in his will.
So in the case of Delaware Avenue, he had this vision for what Delaware Avenue could be as a support infrastructure for the port. And then his investments in coal land and in railroads and in infrastructure on Delaware Avenue were all designed to create a vertically integrated connection in order to put everything that was necessary to have a successful shipping and distribution business within the control of his business empire.
He rebuilds, he invents Delaware Avenue as a major commercial center because he is able to persuade the governor and the mayor that they won't receive anything from his substantial estate unless they commit themselves to do that.
This isn't the first time that he has put his private money to a public use. He was one of the major investors in the First Bank of the United States, and we know that that was crucial for this young American economy that was really fledgling to actually grow and expand and to become stable.
The economy of this country cannot be sustained without a solvent federal bank.
Nor can a nation defend itself. You learned firsthand in 1812.
There was not enough money to fight the war. Imagine the Secretary of the Treasury of the United States being desperate.
And you sent him away.
Yes. But in time, and it took some time, we came to terms, he and I.
By 1812, competition on the high seas between the United States and Great Britain has become so intense that it results in war.
The First National Bank by this point, though, had failed. There was no money in the treasury. It looked very much like the United States could go bankrupt and lose a war at the same time.
The Treasury Secretary literally came to Philadelphia to see Stephen Girard and asked for his help in financing the war. And Girard and a couple of his friends provided that funding and also facilitated the raising of additional funds that enabled the United States to successfully fight the war.
As Stephen Girard became older, he was more overtly philanthropic and also became quite a bit more philosophic.
One must tend his garden. I have thought of this over and over, and I have made myself a fortune. What good can come of all this money?
Girard turns out to have been the fourth wealthiest man in American history. As a self-made man, a man who had managed his affairs from the very beginning, it's natural, of course, that he has some very specific ideas on how he wants that money spent after he's gone.
So in the very same way that you have Bill Gates today using his vast wealth to promote the cause of education, you had Stephen Girard doing the very same thing here in Philadelphia.
The college is a testament to where he came from. He did not start off with much, but he worked really hard and he really put himself out there to learn as much as he could. And he wanted to provide that opportunity for other children.
He wanted to do something for children because that make him feel good inside. For him, it was a way out to prove himself. He was a father and he was a good man.
He saw that if someone didn't do something about this forgotten group, poor white orphan boys, the American society would be at risk.
Girard's vision for his school is a socially innovative idea. Rather than using America's largest fortune to set up an elite university like Harvard or Yale, he's going to use that fortune to set up a school for young boys in need.
There are two big surprises waiting for when Girard's will is read. One of them is the sheer size of his assets, and the other is the shockingly small percentage of those assets which are going to go to his family.
Through the years, Stephen Girard's family was always asking for money, and he knew they were going to contest this will. They were going to hire the best lawyers in America to fight this will.
Daniel Webster, representing the heirs, really focused on the issue of whether or not banning clergy from Girard College would be a violation of the concept of the separation of church and state. Horace Binney represented Girard's estate. Each side took 5 days to argue the case, It turns out to have been one of the monumental cases before the Supreme Court of the 19th century. In the end, the Supreme Court decides in favor of Girard's estate on every single point.
If you will, sir, there is one other matter I'd like to attend to.
Go on, let's get on with it.
It's about this addition on the Ridge Road property. It's a lovely place, sir. I could very well imagine the college rising on that bluff. Nothing quite like this has ever been done before, Mr. Girard.
It's easy to forget that Stephen Girard was a slave owner. The struggle to desegregate Girard College in the 1960s put a blot on the name of Stephen Girard among many Philadelphians.
To set up a school for fatherless white boys today would be unacceptable. But back then, it was a different story.
As far as slave holdings are concerned, the times don't matter at all. Wrong is wrong, and right is right.
It remains unacceptable. But there was no legal precedent at the time to have a racially integrated school. Had Girard wanted to have a diverse school, the irony is, the school would have never opened.
This wall was a great obstacle in the community, and there was a real desire for change. Something had to happen.
That fight actually gave birth to a whole new generation of African-American political leaders. It was a sea change. It was a line of demarcation, and it molded and sparked a whole new array of independent leadership.
I'm proud to be one of the first four to pass through the entrance to desegregate the college. But I'm also proud of what Stephen Girard set out to accomplish and did accomplish. I've always admired him. He was always looking ahead.